And in America, most folks come into abundance, most folks come into wealth, not because they were born there, but because they were brought there. And if you and I are going to come into abundance, it's going to be because God brought us, not because we were born into it. John Walton, Sam Walton, who is the founder of Walmart, when it was said that when he died, he was the richest man in the world.
All right.
And when he died, he left all of his money, all of his holdings, all of his property to his family, to his wife and four children. And he was so rich that when he died and left all of this to his family, his wife and four children immediately became among the top 8 wealthiest people in the world. He was that wealthy. And they were born, those children were born into wealth. They were born into abundance. But you and I, it's too late for us. We ain't born. And if we're going to get into abundance, it's going to be because God brought us into abundance. Y'all playing with me? Notice the scripture says they were brought into abundance. They were brought to this place of praise. And I'm just trying to help you today that to know that if God is going to bring you to, if you haven't already arrived at the place of abundance and praise, I want you to know that God can turn around your situation. He can turn around your circumstances and bring you into a place of praise. But you do that. You do that. You get to that place by praising your way there. You can't just wait on the Lord to bless you. You can't just wait on him to keep his promises to you. You need to praise your way as you journey to the place of praise. Are y'all praying with me? In other words, the place of praise, the place of abundance, and that it's not just up high in the sky when you die. It's not just when you get the house you've been praying for, or the automobile, or the financial wherewithal that you've been looking for. You need to put this right here, wherever you are along the journey, is a good place to praise the Lord. And if you praise the Lord, it'll change your attitude. And if your attitude changes, you'll be surprised how quickly you will get to the place of abundance and the place of praise. Well, hurry up, preacher. Hurry up and tell us, how do we change what we can't change? Because I can't change my place. The Lord's got to bring me to the place of abundance. He's got to bring me to the place of praise. How do I change what I can change, which is my attitude? Praise your way through. In other words, don't you have a bad attitude? I wish I had a witness in here. If you can't say amen, wink amen. Don't you might have a bad attitude? How do you get out of that? Well, you got to praise your way in order to change your attitude. Sometimes you got to change what you say in order to change what you feel. Y'all gonna hit me in a minute. You got to pray, and it's right there in the text. The text says that they began to pray, that he's going to bring you to the place of praise. But you need to start praising God in advance in order to get where he's trying to get you to. In the text it says, in verse 2, they don't wait till they get to verse 12 before they praise.
That's right.
And they start praising all the way in verse 2. You see that?
Yeah. Okay.
Verse 2, and verse 1 says, shout with joy to God. All the earth. Verse 2 says, sing the glory of his name. Make his praise glorious. We ain't even got close to verse 12 yet. When he brings them, when he brought them into a place of praise, an abundant place. Verse 4 says, all the earth. Y'all in y'all Bible? Some of y'all looking at me, you ain't looking at your Bible. That's why you can't praise. That's why you can't worship, because you're looking at me and you need to be looking at the word. Are y'all gonna pray with me in here? Look what the word says. Verse 4 says, all the earth bows down to you. They sing praise to you. They sing praise to your name. And then verse 8 says, praise our God.
Yes, sir.
O peoples, let the sound of his praise be heard.
All, right.
All of this shouting and singing. is happening before they get to the place of abundance.
Yes,
do y'all see that?
Yes,
in other words, if you're going to get to the place God wants you to be, to the place of abundance and praise, then you need to praise your way there. And somebody said, well, what am I praising for? I'm not in the place yet. I don't have the promises of God that he made to me. I don't have, I'm looking around, my family seems to be falling apart, my bills and my finances are all jacked up. I got all kinds of problems. I got children that won't listen and won't do what they're supposed to do. What am I praising for? It's right there in the text. He says, first of all, you need to praise him for his person. Praise him for his character. Where is that, preacher? It's right there in verse number 2. It says, sing the glory of his name.
Right.
Praise him for his name.
Yes, sir.
Because his name is an indication of his character.
Right.
He is the God, the sovereign of the ages. He is the creator of all things.
Right.
Praise him for who he is. Praise him for his person. I can praise him for who he is no matter what's going on in my life. God is who he is, and he is in my life what I need him to be. And so I need to praise him just for that. Before he opens a door, before he makes a way, before he blesses, before he sends a blessing, a financial blessing, or heal my body, I ought to be praising him for who he is.
He
said, praise him for his purpose, for his person. I'm not going to keep you long. It also helps us to understand that we can praise and change our attitude so we can get to the place of abundance. He said, praise him for what he's done in the past.
Yeah.
Praise him for his person and praise him for the past.
Yeah.
What are you talking about, preacher? He said, praise God for what he's already done.
Yeah.
Praise him for the bills he's already paid.
Yeah.
Praise him for the healing he's already brought.
Yeah.
Praise him for the peace he's already wrought. Praise him for what he's already done in your life.
Yes,
and I know I'm in the text because the scripture says, listen, he says in verse 6, he turned the sea into dry land.
Yeah.
And they passed through the waters on foot.
Yeah.
In other words, he put something that didn't belong where he put it.
Yeah.
In order to make a way for his people to escape.
Yeah.
And then in the 14th chapter of the book of Exodus, the Bible tells us that Moses and the children of God were leaving Egyptian bondage. On that way, they came up against the Red Sea. The Bible says that Pharaoh and his army were in hot pursuit. And they got to the Red Sea, and there was no place for them to escape. Scripture says God opened up a way. He opened up the Red Sea and put a paved street in the Red Sea, on the Red Sea floor, that his people could walk through on dry land. And y'all know pavement don't go in the sea. Y'all gonna hear me in a minute. You know that roads don't go through the sea, but God made a way out of no way. And so the writer says, if you can't think of nothing today to praise him for what he's already done in your past. Are y'all praying with me? He said, praise him for the past. And I love this because it helps me to understand when I stop thinking about God's resume, I stop thinking about what ain't happening today and what didn't work out today. I stop thinking about his resume in my past, and I can't help but give him praise. Oh, y'all don't know what a resume is for. What a resume, the boys and boys to men learn what a resume is for. When you're looking for a job and you go to apply for a job, you need to bring a resume.
Yes, sir.
Why do you need a resume, Pastor? You need a resume because the employer wants a history of what you have done in order to get an understanding of what you will do if he gives you a job.
Yes, sir.
That's what a resume does. And I know what God is going to do because of his resume, which tells me what he has done.
Yes.
He has made a way out of nowhere.
Yes.
He has opened doors that no man can close. Yes. He has closed doors that no man can open.
Yes.
He has come to camp. Oh, y'all don't hear.
Yes.
Y'all don't like football. Let me give you a baseball analogy. In baseball, when a player comes up to the plate and he hits the ball over the fence, that's called a
home run.
Thank you for helping me preach today. That's a home run. But one of the things about home runs is as soon as as the ball goes out of the field and over the fence, everybody starts celebrating.
Yes, sir.
Teammates start clapping.
Yes.
Crowds start cheering.
Yes, sir.
The base runner puts his hands up because he done hit a home run.
Yes, sir.
But if you ever watch the scoreboard, the home run doesn't register until the base runner runs the bases.
Yes,
and hits every base.
Yes,
and goes home.
Yes,
y'all gonna see this in a minute. And when he touches home, that's when the home run registers.
Yes,
because it's not really a home run until after he gets home.
Yes,
and so while some of y'all waiting for the home run to register, let me tell you, you might as well go and praise God right now. You ain't gotta wait till you get home. You don't have to wait till you touch all the bases. You can give him praise right now. Because Jesus already hit a home run. I know your bills need to be paid. I know you still have Christmas shopping to do. But Jesus already hit a home run. He did it back on Calvary's cross. So why y'all gonna raise your hands? Why ain't somebody clapping in here? Why ain't somebody cheering in here? Jesus already gave you the victory. Praise him for what he's done in the past. But not only that, you can praise him for the pain in your present. That's it, Pastor. You lost me now. You let me go right there. I can't praise him for pain. I'm in pain every day. I get up in the morning, man. My legs hurt, and my knees hurt, and my wrist is hurting. Come on, somebody. My neck hurts when I put my feet on the floor and my feet hurt. I'm praying that he take all that out of my life. I'm praying that he removes burdens. But the Bible says we need to praise him for the pain. What are you talking about? But it's right there in the text. In verse 8 it says, praise our God, O peoples, let the sound of the praise be heard. Verse 9, he has preserved our lives and kept our feet from slipping. But look at verse 10. For you, O God, tested us. You refined us like silver. Not only that, look what it says in verse 12. It said, you let men ride over our heads. We went through the fire and the water. That's trouble. I ain't gonna take long to unpack that, but you need to know that the fire and water, you know fire represents trouble.
Yes,
but the fire and water represents trouble and chaos in our experience. And you let our haters be over us.
Right.
Y'all see that?
Yes,
and look what the scripture says. The scripture says that in verse 10, but you did it to prepare us for the place of praise.
Yes, sir.
In other words, with the nation of Israel, if I can stay contextual, if I can stay in the context, with the nation of Israel, God didn't just bring them up to a place of abundance and praise. He brought them gradually. They spent hundreds of years in Egyptian bondage. And then he brought them through the water. And he brought them through the Red Sea. He brought them through the wilderness for 40 more years.